Good morning. Good afternoon, dear students. Always good morning.
Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon, sir.
Okay.
Good afternoon, sir.
So, fine. After your test, before the festival. So, let's have this class. Today, we are going to start a new chapter. Okay. The new chapter is States of Matter. Because of this postponement of your examination, States of Matter had to be done now, actually. Otherwise, it would have been done before. No problem. There is little gas loss and all, which will be considered in thermodynamics in solving problems and all those things. You would have seen that P1 V1 is equal to P2 V2, these kind of formula and all. They are basically from States of Matter. Okay, fine. When I say States of Matter, let me before we can actually get into the actual concepts of the syllabus, we need certain things as a preamble introduction to this chapter. We need certain concepts from chemical bonding. We need polarity and dipole moment, these kind of concepts. We shall have a brief revision of those concepts from chemical bonding and then get into states of matter. Okay, so we'll take up so preamble to states of matter. Before that, you know, in chemical bond, is it chemical bonding complete for you? Chemical bonding?
Sandeep sir is doing MOT now.
Okay, otherwise...
that is there. Rest is done.
So, rest is done. That's fine. Just MOT. MOT, where exactly? Postulate, sir.
He started it last class.
So we'll take up, no problem. We know this polar and non-polar molecules, such kind of concept, right? So we have this idea.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So I'll just give you some molecules. You have to tell me whether they are polar or non-polar. Okay. So when I take simple molecule like chlorine, polar or non-polar?
Non-polar.
Non-polar. Okay. When I take HCl?
Polar.
So, what is one thing we can generalize under these two examples, chlorine and HCl? Chlorine is a diatomic molecule. Is it homodiatomic molecule or heterodiatomic molecule?
Homo.
Homo.
Homo. HCl?
Hetero.
Hetero.
Can you make one generalized statement that in case of diatomic molecule, if it is hetero diatomic molecule, it will be polar. And if it is a homodiatomic molecule, it will be non-polar. Can we make that a generalization?
No, sir.
Why not?
Yes, sir. In case of diatomic molecules, it can.
In case
some of hetero...
We can make it. Okay? Homodiatomic molecules are generally non-polar. Heterodiatomic molecules are polar. We can make it. Right? For example, we'll take one more case. You take O2. Polar or non-polar?
Non-polar.
Correct. CO.
Polar.
Polar. So a molecule which contains similar atoms can be non-polar because electronegativity is same, equal sharing of electrons of the bond. So non-polar. When the molecule is having different atoms, hetero molecule, then electronegativity will be different. And thus, electron sharing will be different. It will be polar. That's as simple as that. Okay. Question is, how about this? Is it hetero molecule or homo molecule?
Hetero.
Hetero.
Is it polar or non-polar?
non-polar.
What about others?
Non-polar.
CO2 is polar or non-polar?
Non-polar.
Sure, but it is having different atoms. So shall I say it is non-polar? Okay. What is the reason behind carbon dioxide, despite of having different atoms of obviously different electronegativity, why it is non-polar?
The dipoles are in opposite directions.
So dipole moments will get cancelled, right?
They will get
carbon
canceled.
Dioxide is a linear molecule. Carbon dioxide is a linear molecule. And dipole moment get cancelled. Okay. So when I say that, dipole moment will always be acting towards more electronegative atom. So mu is the symbol for dipole moment. It get cancelled. So whenever the mu value, net mu value is zero, such molecules, though they have different atoms in the molecule, can be entitled as non-polar molecules. Okay, so fine, SO2. CO2 non-polar, similarly SO2 is same, no? In the place of carbon, there is sulfur.
No, sir, shape will be different. It will be polar.
Okay, or how about others? Is it polar or non-polar? No idea?
Polar, sir.
Okay, no, I just want others to answer. Huh? How about remaining?
It's polar.
Okay, polar. Who is this answer? Who's this?
Saranga, sir.
Who spoke? Pardon me?
Saranga.
Saranga. It's polar. Saranga, can you tell me why it is polar? It's polar. Now, the reason behind polarity, sulfur dioxide.
It's bent like water.
It's bent molecule. How many lone pair of electrons are there in sulfur? On sulfur
atom?
One lone pair? Sure. So totally six valence electrons. So one dative bond, totally. Here two electrons are used for oxygen, double bond. So one lone. So because of this, it is bent. The bent structure is because of lone pair, bond pair repulsion. That we know that, right? So towards which atom the dipole moment will be acting or pointed out?
Oxygen.
Towards sulfur or oxygen?
Oxygen.
Oxygen. So dipole moment will be acting towards the oxygen. So they are not equal and opposite. So mu, dipole moment of this molecule, is not equal to zero. Any molecule which has net dipole moment is said to be polar. So whether the molecule is polar or non-polar depends on the composition of the atom or the structure of the atom.
Structure.
Both.
Okay, so both is correct. How is both? Okay, we'll take some example. CH4, polar or non-polar?
Non-polar.
Reason?
They cancel each other.
Net dipole is zero.
What is the structure of CH3?
Tetrahedral.
Okay, tetrahedral structure is symmetrical structure. The dipole moment will get completely canceled off. Okay, the dipole moment will be acting towards carbon or hydrogen?
Carbon.
So it will all act equally and they get cancelled out. Okay, so in that way mu becomes equal to zero, therefore it is non-polar. Whereas how about this CH3Cl? What is the structure of CH3Cl?
It's also tetrahedral.
Tetrahedral. Polar or non-polar?
Polar.
Polar.
What is the reason? CH4 is also tetrahedral, CH3Cl is also tetrahedral. But CH4 is polar and CH3Cl is, CH4 is non-polar, CH3Cl is polar. What is the reason?
Chlorine is more electronegative.
So it depends on the composition, just not the structure. Okay. So when I say that, you can look at the structure here. Okay. So there is net dipole moment, which will not cancel out here. So mu not equal to zero. Net dipole moment, therefore dispolar. So polarity of a molecule depends on composition as well as the structure. If the surrounding atom in a particular molecule is all same, and apart from that, that molecule has symmetric structure where dipole moment get cancelled, then it becomes non-polar. If surrounding atom are different, despite of having symmetric structure, the dipole moment will not get cancelled and that molecule will be polar. So this is what we can say, right? So this is about polarity. So we can say one thing here. Any polar molecule has dipole, right? A polar molecule possesses net dipole moment. Okay, so it will have a dipole, mu not equal to zero. Is the conclusion. And a non-polar molecule. And a non-polar molecule possesses no net dipole moment, which means mu equal to zero. So you have to look at the composition, you have to look at the structure, and then decide on dipole, whether the molecule has net dipole moment or not. If it has net dipole moment, polar. No net dipole moment, non-polar. Such question wouldn't arise in case of a diatomic molecule. If it is homo, equally shared, therefore mu becomes zero and therefore non-polar. If it is a hetero, for example, in case of HCl, different atoms are there. So it will be acting, mu will be acting towards Cl and therefore it is polar. Mu not equal to zero. And mu equal to zero for homo diatomic molecule. Directly you can say. Fine, this is about polarity and non-polarity. The reason behind it is the structure and composition, which results in net dipole moment or not. Based on that, we will decide. Okay. Next, we'll take. See, molecules in different substances do exist in solid, liquid, gaseous state under normal conditions. The same substance existing in different physical states, solid, liquid, gaseous state, will have different physical properties, but the chemical properties doesn't change. Okay, so chemical properties of the substance remain same in different physical states. However, the physical properties would change. If at all, if some chemical properties also, if it is changing, it may not be exactly chemical property, but what we can consider is the rate of the reaction or velocity of the reaction would change. Generally, in liquid state, rate of the reaction will be more, and gaseous state much more. Solid state, reactivity in most of the cases, it will be zero, and in some cases, it would react. Okay. So, as physical state changes, only chemical reactivity, the rate of a reaction, what we call, or velocity of a reaction, would only change, whereas chemical property by nature would not change. Only physical properties will change. Substances do exist in different physical states. Is it okay? So under normal conditions, some substances exist as solid, some substances at the same conditions of temperature and pressure would exist as liquid and gases. Now, how come this kind of difference would be there? Why certain substances do exist as gaseous state under normal condition, whereas certain substances exist as solid and liquid? So what makes them exist in different physical state under given conditions of temperature and pressure? So all the substances should have the same physical state. What could be the reason? Can anybody guess it or give your viewpoint about it?
Interactions between the atoms, molecules.
Interaction between the atoms and molecule is the reason for it. Okay, apart from that? That's all? Only interaction. Is there any other reason as to why substances do exist in solid, liquid, and gaseous state? Only interaction.
It depends on the kinetic energy of the atoms.
Kinetic energy of the atom. If you speak about kinetic energy, something relates to the energy of the motion of the molecule. If you speak of one molecule, one atom in a substance, it is kinetic energy. If you speak of average kinetic energy of all the molecules, all the atoms, all the ions in a substance, in general, ions or molecules or atoms in a substance are called particles. So if you speak kinetic energy of all the particles, we give a terminology for that as thermal energy. Thermal energy arises due to the motion of particles. When I say particle, it's general, atom, ion or molecule. Thermal energy arises due to motion of particles. It is the average of the kinetic energy of all the particles in a matter. So thermal energy, so when you say kinetic energy of a molecule, it is the thermal energy when we speak in bulk of the matter, okay? So bulk of the matter when you speak, it is thermal energy. So what you mentioned is correct. The kinetic energy for bulk, it is thermal energy. Now two factors will decide the physical state of matter, whether it is solid, liquid or gaseous state. That is intermolecular forces, and another one is thermal energy. Okay. So generally, what is thermal energy firstly? Thermal energy arises due to the motion of particles in a substance. Motion of particles in a substance, and it's the average of kinetic energy of, it's the average of kinetic energy of all the particles. Average of kinetic energy of all the particles in a matter or in a substance. Since it is nothing but average of kinetic energy, you know, it directly depends on temperature. When temperature increases, kinetic energy increases. So overall, thermal energy also increases. So what we can say is thermal energy is directly proportional to the temperature. Directly proportional to temperature. So when I say solid state, liquid and gaseous state of a matter, so in which state there will be highest thermal energy?
Gas.
So when matter changes from solid to liquid to the gaseous state, okay, to the gas state. So generally temperature has to increase, right? So for example, water under 0 degrees centigrade, it is solid. Under room temperature, it is liquid. Under 100 degrees centigrade, it is gas. So temperature has to increase here. Temperature has to increase. When temperature increases, then only physical state changes from solid to liquid to gas. And therefore thermal energy also increases. Thermal energy also increases. Okay. So among solid, liquid, gaseous state of matter, the gaseous state has highest thermal energy than liquid and than solid state. That's the meaning. Okay. Now intermolecular forces. we need to speak about intermolecular forces. See, intermolecular forces are also responsible for existence of matter in a particular physical state. It is not just the thermal energy. It is also intermolecular forces. Now, what are these intermolecular forces? We have seen different bonding. Okay, so you would have studied in under chemical bonding, an ionic bond, a covalent bond, a coordinate bond, a metallic bond. Did metallic bond has been discussed? How about metallic bond? Has it been discussed?
Briefly, sir.
Pardon me?
Yes, sir. Briefly.
Briefly. Okay. Can you tell me what is a metallic bond?
In metals, it's like the sea of electrons one.
Okay. So, concept of metallic bond is entirely different from all other bonds. For example, in a covalent bond, the electrons are shared equally to form a covalent bond, correct? Mutual sharing up of unpaired electrons in the valence shell of combining atom will result in the formation of a covalent bond. Whereas a coordinate bond is formed by donating a pair of electrons from one atom to the other atom and then sharing. So coordinate bond, in a way, it is similar to covalent bond, but only thing is the two electrons required for the formation of bond will come from one bond partner. So if two electrons required for the bond formation, if it is donated by one atom to another and then shared, then it is coordinate bond. If it is mutually shared, just covalent bond. So coordinate bond is almost similar to covalent bond for the reason that both of them have two electrons. Okay. So that's why coordinate bond is also called coordinate covalent bond also. So in terms, many terms, both will be similar. Similarly, ionic bond. An ionic bond is formed by, how do we get an ionic bond?
Transfer of electrons.
Transfer of electrons. Okay. So when I say ionic bond, it is transfer of electron. From valence shell of one to another. Meaning one to another means I have written in brief, one atom to another atom. Okay. So fine. Covalent bond. Sharing of unpaired electrons. Sharing of unpaired electrons in the valence shell of combining atoms. Then coordinate bond, donating a pair of electrons from one atom to another atom. Okay. So the concept of metallic bond is different. Concept of metallic bond is quite different. In all other cases, electrons are firmly fixed in the bond. Whereas in metallic bond, the concept itself is different. The electrons in the metallic bond are not firmly fixed. It is imagined to be the electrostatic force of attraction. Metallic bond is an electrostatic force of attraction between negative sea of electron and positive array of metal ions or kernel of ions, we say. Kernels, we say. Correct, no? So it is basically electrostatic force. Electrostatic force of attraction between negative sea of electrons. ENS, I have written electrons, and positive array of metal ions. This is brief about all the different bonds that we have had in chemical bonding. Is it okay? So metallic bond is electrostatic in nature. Which is the other bond also electrostatic in nature? Which is the other bond which is also electrostatic in nature? When I say electrostatic, it is the opposite electrostatic force of attraction that exists between a positive and negative particle, right? So metallic bond is electrostatic. Which is the other bond that is electrostatic?
Ionic
bond, as simple as that. Of course, it is, for that reason, it is the two electrons which are involved in covalent bond and coordinate bond. It is not opposite force of attraction existing between particles. Otherwise, it is just force of attraction. A bond is simply a force of attraction that holds any two constituent particles together. Okay. When I say intermolecular forces, we don't use the word bond here. Intermolecular bond, we don't say. It is particularly referred as intermolecular forces. Okay. Because these intermolecular forces, which we are going to study under this heading, have bond strength which is less than these bonds. Okay, the bond energy of these forces are much weaker when compared to the conventional bonds what we have: ionic bond, covalent bond, metallic bond, and all those things. That's why they are just called as intermolecular forces or intermolecular interactions. But you just can't neglect them. Intermolecular forces, though they are very weak in comparison with these conventional bonds, but they can't be neglected. In bulk, they operate and change the physical state itself. Okay, so intermolecular forces therefore are damn important when you take bulk of the matter. Okay, for example, so I would just give one statement for this and then move on to the example. So what is intermolecular forces? These are weak forces. And these weak forces are also called van der Waal forces, attributing this concept to the scientist van der Waal, who actually gave the concept for the first time. Okay, so weak forces operating between any two molecules or atoms, between any two molecules or atoms. That means, see, look at the statement: weak forces operating between any two molecules or atoms. They are called intermolecular. That means, of any nature, you bring the molecule together, there will be some weak intermolecular forces that will generate and operate. Okay, so I deliberately avoided ions there. If you bring two opposite ions together, what kind of force you expect? Is it force or bond that you will generate? It becomes an
ionic bond.
Ionic bond.
It becomes an example of ionic bond. So a bond is much stronger when compared to these intermolecular forces. That's why let us not bring opposite ions together. Okay, but when you bring it two similar ions together, then there is a possibility that you can have a intermolecular forces. So weak forces operating between any two molecules or atoms are called intermolecular forces. They are also referred as called van der Waal forces. Van der Waal forces. These forces individually may be very weak, but in bulk, they operate in such a way that they induce significant difference in physical properties. That is very important. Okay, we'll take some minutes. Okay. These forces. Okay. These forces in bulk change the physical properties of matter significantly. Okay, now, when you take an example, these halogens, halogens, 17th group elements. Can you name halogens? First one?
Fluorine.
Next?
Chlorine.
Next?
Bromine.
Hmm.
Iodine.
Hmm. One last one? Why we
arsenic.
Consider fluorine to iodine, not the last one? Which is last one?
Astatine.
Astatine. Okay. And this is radioactive element. Just leave that. Okay. So, except that these are all quite stable. Now, what is the physical state of fluorine?
Gas.
Gas? For sure?
Sir.
Yes, okay. Sir.
This is gas. Chlorine?
Gas.
How about bromine?
Liquid.
Iodine?
Solid.
Look at that. So, fluorine to iodine when we move down, okay? So, physical state has changed. Okay? Gas becomes liquid. Liquid becomes solid. How come it has happened like this? The reason for this is, see, down the group of 17, okay? Down the group. What happens to molecular mass? Atomic mass increases. When atomic mass increases, molecular mass has to increase. So down the group of 17th group elements, molecular mass increases. When molecular mass increases, van der Waal forces also increases. See, van der Waal force. Are directly proportional to the molecular mass. Okay. So they are directly proportional. That's the reason why as we move down the group, when molecular mass increases, van der Waal forces also increase. So the magnitude of van der Waal forces that operate in iodine is much more. That's why all the molecules are held strongly and the physical state is solid there. Whereas van der Waal forces in the fluorine is very weak and there the physical state is the gaseous state. And it is moderate in the bromine, that's why physical state is liquid. Similar example you can see in many homologous series of organic compounds. So in different homologous series, organic compounds, what actually happens? As molecular mass increases, van der Waal forces increase. Okay, so van der Waal forces increase. Therefore, gaseous state becomes liquid as molecular mass increases and it becomes solid yet. Correct, no? So that is observed in all the homologous series. What do you mean by homologous series?
The alkanes, alkenes, and the alkynes.
Homologous series means family of closely related compound. One family is one homologous series. We people have in our, among humans, So we say they are, Shetru family, Gowdru family, Inyaro family, Patelro family. Okay. Each surname is one family. Okay. In that way, surname would be a homologous series. Like that, even in organic compounds, all closely related compounds are one family. It is referred as homologous series. Alkanes, one family. Haloalkanes, another family. Carboxylic acid. All carboxylic acids, one family. Family of people behave similar. If at all one person is behaving differently, there could be some genetic modification. Otherwise, it should be same, right? So in that way, organic compounds of close resemblance, which are related to one another very closely, they're all called one family of compound that is referred as homologous series. So for example, you can take alkanes up to butane, it is gas, and then go up to 16 or 17, it is liquid. Beyond that, it becomes a solid. That's all because of van der Waal forces. Now, we have understood what are this intermolecular forces. nothing but van der Waals forces. And also we know now thermal energy. Thermal energy, no confusion, it is nothing but kinetic energy. Kinetic energy, when we speak, it refers to one particular atom, molecule, something like that. So in bulk of the matter, for if you refer average kinetic energy of all the particles, then it becomes thermal energy. As a result, thermal energy is directly proportional to absolute temperature. The physical state of matter is a resultant of this intermolecular forces and thermal energy. Is that okay? It's a resultant of intermolecular force and thermal energy. Okay. So I can make a statement. A physical state matter is a result of thermal energy and the intermolecular forces. Thermal energy and the intermolecular forces. Okay. So when you take different states of matter, I've given you already for this thermal energy, solid to liquid to the gaseous state. If I write arrow mark like this, tell me, from solid to gas, what will increase between thermal energy and intermolecular forces?
Thermal energy.
Thermal energy increases. And how about intermolecular forces from solid to gas?
Decreases.
Intermolecular forces will decrease. The gaseous state is the one which has least intermolecular forces, while the solid state will have maximum. Okay. Now, we have different intermolecular forces operating. So when I say van der Waals forces, nothing but intermolecular forces, how did we define? Weak forces operating between any two molecules or any two atoms is what is van der Waals forces. Okay. So when I say any two atoms or any two molecule, how come it is possible? Can van der Waals forces operate between every molecule? Yes, it is there possible. So that's what we are going to study now. How come van der Waals forces operate between any two molecules, irrespective of the nature? So we are going to discuss what are all the possible van der Waals forces between molecules. Okay. Van der Waals forces they can operate between any two molecules or atoms. Okay. Now if you find out the reason behind the development of van der Waals forces, they could also give rise to different types. Okay, so let me give this identity, types of van der Waals forces. Okay, first one, number one, it is called dipole force. Or interaction, dipole force. Now tell me, which kind of molecules are expected to possess permanent dipoles?
Polar molecules.
Because polar molecules will have net dipole moment. A pole is a charged end. Dipole means two charged ends. For example, when you take HCl, It has a permanent dipole, we say, because Cl minus has little negative charge. Little is delta, delta negative, and hydrogen has little positive charge. When I say that delta, the magnitude of that negative charge, delta negative, delta positive, would be less than 1 unit of positive or negative charge. For example, when you take NaCl, in case of NaCl, Cl minus has 1 unit of negative charge. How much is 1 unit of negative charge? -1.602 × 10⁻¹⁹ coulomb. The charge on one electron. The charge on one electron is 1 unit of negative charge. Likewise, this sodium has 1 positive charge. 1 unit of positive charge is equal to +1.602 × 10⁻¹⁹ coulomb. That is the charge on one proton. So that is NaCl has complete 1 unit of positive charge and 1 unit of negative charge. Whereas in case of HCl, it's a covalent molecule. There is partial negative and partial positive charge, which is arising due to electronegativity difference. So Cl is having slightly negative charge and hydrogen has slight positive charge. It is much less than 1 unit of charge, be it positive or negative. And these forces are just due to those partial charges. If at all, if some force is arising between ions with uninegative charge and unipositive charge, it can't be intermolecular forces. It becomes ionic bond. Okay, so that is the case of NaCl or calcium oxide or magnesium fluoride, anything like that. Okay, fine. Dipole-dipole forces. These dipole-dipole forces are van der Waals forces. They operate between two molecules which possess permanent dipoles. When I say the molecules which possess permanent dipole, it is like HCl. HCl has hydrogen and positive and Cl and negative, and this polarity, charge, polarity is charge. This Cl is one pole, negative pole. The hydrogen is the positive pole. And thus HCl has two poles, that is dipole. It has permanent dipole. And when two such molecules come closer, the force of attraction that arises is what is a dipole-dipole interaction is. Okay, so this is the interaction. Arising between two polar molecules. Two polar molecules which possess permanent dipoles, right? Of course, it is by default, they possess permanent dipoles. Which possess permanent dipoles. So how things happen? How do we generally represent? See, a dipole is always represented by symbolically like this. If there is a molecule which can be represented by this circle like this. Okay. This has a dipole, means one end being negative, another end is positive. This is a dipole. Diagrammatically, when one molecule of this kind interact with another, it always orient in such a way that the positive end of one dipole will be pointed towards the negative end of the other due to electrostatic force of attraction. So when I write one more, this dipole, a molecule with the dipole, would orient itself in such a way that the negative end will be pointing towards the positive, and it is a partial negative or positive charge, right? And there will be weak electrostatic force of attraction. That weak electrostatic force of attraction is nothing but this van der Waals force. Okay, so this is a dipole and this is also a dipole. Okay. So thus, between two molecules which are polar, or between two molecules which possess permanent dipole, there will be weak van der Waals forces operating. Okay. So one case is when two different molecules which are polar come closer, we know that there will be weak intermolecular forces that will generate. Can you give an example of this particular case? An example of a substance which can develop these kind of dipole-dipole forces. I've written there only.
HCl.
HCl is over. Okay, I can get, give HCl. Apart from that. Any other example where two molecules can interact in this manner and develop dipole-dipole forces?
HF.
HF, HBr. Okay, all hydrates of 17th group. Over. Next. Particularly...
carbon monoxide.
Like that. Particularly HF will have a different interaction. Can you tell me that?
Hydrogen bond.
That's why we consider that one, the weak interaction that would develop in HF is hydrogen bonding, and that will be stronger bond or stronger interaction when we compare to this dipole-dipole. So
H2O
has hydrogen bond. Okay.
H2O.
H2O again, does it come under this dipole-dipole interaction?
Hydrogen bond again.
Hydrogen. Okay. So we shall give it later. Okay. CO, somebody told CO. CO, can it be given as an example under dipole-dipole force, CO? Correct, no? Is CO a dipole molecule? Is it polar?
Yes.
The moment when I say polar, carbon has what charge?
Positive.
Delta? Positive. Oxygen has? Delta negative.
Delta negative.
When two carbon monoxide molecules come closer, how do they orient? It becomes like this again. So this is delta positive and delta negative. So there will be weak dipole-dipole interaction. So CO can be anything. Can SO2 be example of this kind?
Yes.
SO2. Okay. Can NO2, NO, they all can be ones which have this dipole-dipole interaction. Nitric oxide, nitrogen dioxide, something like that. Okay. No problem. Can I give an example of... O3 as an example here, ozone. Under this?
No.
Why?
It's non-polar.
So anyhow, we'll take up further. So we can't give O2 or O3 under dipole-dipole. So I think this has been understood. I'll go to next reason behind the generation of the van der Waal forces. That is next type. Dipole-dipole. That means when two polar molecules come closer, it is an example of dipole-dipole interaction. Next, when one polar comes near the another polar molecule, another non-polar molecule, when one polar comes near another non-polar molecule, then also you can develop these interaction, weak intermolecular forces, the van der Waal forces. So in such cases, the interaction is said to be dipole-induced pole interaction. Dipole-induced pore interaction. Okay. See, this dipole-induced pore interaction, dipole is there in a molecule which is permanently polar. Induced pore would happen instantly in a molecule which is non-polar. Okay. So, a polar molecule, you should know always, a polar molecule will have permanent dipole. Permanent dipole. Whereas a non-polar molecule will have no permanent dipole. Correct. But when a polar molecule interacts with a non-polar molecule, the non-polar molecule, then there develops a momentary dipole into this. Okay, then there will be dipole induced pole interaction. dipole induced pole interaction develops. Okay, so thus between a polar and a non-polar molecule, we can expect a weak van der Waals forces to develop. We'll take one diagrammatic representation. So if I represent a molecule like this, so at the core it is nucleus which is positive. Okay, so now the negative charges are uniformly distributed. So can you tell me what could be this? Is it a polar molecule or a non-polar molecule? What kind of representation? Negative is uniformly distributed.
Non-polar.
It can be indicating the non-polar molecule. Non-polar. When it interacts with a polar molecule, a polar molecule will have a dipole, two charged ends. Negative levels. So this is polar molecule with a dipole. Okay. Now when they interact, come closer, what would happen? This positive end of the polar molecule will attract the negative electron cloud. That means the electrons are uniformly distributed or they are symmetrically distributed in the molecule. So that polarity will be not there. Okay. The molecule will be completely non-polar. When the dipole interacts with the non-polar molecule, momentarily polarity is induced. Why? Because the positive end of the dipole will attract the negative electron. That means it distorts the negative electron cloud, we say. Idu ee cloud and the negative charge anta yake bere bere cloud andre distort antane use maadbeku. Okay, charge andre it will attract and induce the polarity in theory. Ee cloud concept enakke barutte. Generally, electrons are assumed to be waves. A wave distribution around the nucleus, boundary surface diagram, it is the kind of uniform distribution across the nucleus. If it is spherical, it becomes S orbital. If it is dumbbell, it is P orbital. When I say cloud of electron around the nucleus will be get distorted, is the right word there. Okay. So when polar molecule come near the non-polar, the positive end attracts the negative charge or distort the negative electron cloud in the non-polar molecule and induce momentarily polarity. Okay, so fine. Okay, so here also polarity gets induced. So this becomes minus, the other end becomes plus. Now the interaction between plus and minus end will arise, that is electrostatic. This itself is a van der Waals interaction, which can be called as a dipole induced pole interaction. A dipole and induced pole interaction, that's the thing. Okay. So that means when one polar molecule interact with another non-polar molecule, then also weak forces will be possible. What I mean by saying, between any two molecule or any two atoms, there can be van der Waals forces. We have seen two categories. Give some example of this particular kind. Anybody? Can you give an example where this particular kind of van der Waals forces generate between actual molecules? Gopal? Gopal, are you there?
Yes, sir.
Artha akti di napa?
Sir, artha akti, sir.
Idakke example kodu. Jai Teertha?
Yes, sir.
Artha akti diya? Ena doubts diya?
Yes, sir. Chanaga artha akti diya, sir.
ಅಲ್ಲ ಡೌಟ್ಸ್ ಇದೆಯಾ ಅಂದ್ರೆ ಸರ್ ಅಂದೆ
ಡೌಟ್ಸ್ ಇದೆ ಹಾಗೆ ನೋ ಆನ್ಸರ್
ಸರಿ ಅಲ್ಲ ಡೌಟ್ಸ್ ಕೇಳ್ತಿದ್ರೇನೆ ಅರ್ಥ ಆಗ್ತಿದೆ ಅಂತ ದಿ ಸೈನ್ ಆಫ್ ಅಂಡರ್ಸ್ಟ್ಯಾಂಡಿಂಗ್ ಈಸ್ ಕೆಲಸತಿ ಕೇಳೋದು ಕ್ವಶನ್ ಕೇಳ್ತಿದ್ರೆ ಅರ್ಥ ಆಗ್ತಿದೆ ಅಂತ ಕ್ವಶನ್ ಕೇಳ್ದಿದ್ರೆ ಎರಡು, ಒಂದು ಅರ್ಥ ಆಗ್ತಿಲ್ಲ ಇಲ್ಲ ಕಂಪ್ಲೀಟ್ ಅರ್ಥ ಆಗಿದೆ. ಸೊ ಯಾವುದು?
ಕಂಪ್ಲೀಟ್ ಅರ್ಥ ಆಗಿದೆ ಸರ್.
ಸರಿ ಅಪ್ಪ. ಇಲ್ಲಿ ಸುಶ್ರುತ್ ಇದನಾ? ಸುಶ್ರುತ ಸುಶ್ರುತ ಇಲ್ವೇನೆಯ ಗೋಪಾಲ್?
ಸುಶ್ರುತ ಇಲ್ಲ ಸರ್.
ಏಕೆ?
ಇವತ್ತು ಊರಿಗೆ ಹೋಗ್ತಿದ್ದಾನೆ ಸರ್. ಅದಕ್ಕೆ
ಅಲ್ಲಿಂದನೇ ಎಂಟರ್ ಆಗ್ಬೋದಲ್ಲ?
ಏನೋ ಪ್ರಾಬ್ಲಮ್ ಆಗಿದೆ ಅಂತ ಸರ್.
ಹೌದಾ? ಸರಿ,
ಟ್ರಾವೆಲಿಂಗ್ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಇದ್ದಾನೆ ಸರ್.
ಓಕೆ ಓಕೆ
ಸರ್. H2O ಆಗ್ಬೋದಾ ಸರ್?
H2O H2O ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಏನಾಗುತ್ತೆ ನಾನು ಹೇಳಿದ್ನಲ್ಲ, H2O ಕ್ಯಾನ್ ಬಿ ಎ ಡೈಪೋಲ್ ಬಿಟ್ವೀನ್ ಟೂ ಡೈಪೋಲ್ 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 ಇಂಟ್ರಾಕ್ಷನ್ ಇರುತ್ತೆ. ಬಟ್ ಇಲ್ಲಿ ಸ್ಪೆಷಲ್ ಕೇಸ್ ಏನಪ್ಪಾ ಅಂದ್ರೆ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಹೈಡ್ರೋಜನ್ ಬಾಂಡ್ ಬಂದ್ಬಿಡುತ್ತೆ. ಡೈಪೋಲ್ಗಿಂತನೂ ಹೈಡ್ರೋಜನ್ ಬಾಂಡ್ ಸ್ಟ್ರಾಂಗ್ ಇರೋದ್ರಿಂದ ಬಿಕಾಸ್ ಆಫ್ ದಟ್ ಹೈಡ್ರೋಜನ್ ಬಾಂಡ್ ವಿಚ್ ಇಸ್ ಸ್ಟ್ರಾಂಗ್ H2O ಗೆಟ್ಸ್ ಮೋರ್ ಸ್ಟೆಬಿಲೈಸ್ಡ್. ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಡೈಪೋಲ್ ಡೈಪೋಲ್ ಇಂಟ್ರಾಕ್ಷನ್ ಅಲ್ಲ, ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಹೈಡ್ರೋಜನ್ ಬಾಂಡ್ ಇನ್ನು ಸ್ಟ್ರಾಂಗರ್ ಬಾಂಡ್ ಬರುತ್ತೆ. ಸೊ ವಿ ಕಾಂಟ್ ಗಿವ್ ಎನ್ ಎಕ್ಸಾಂಪಲ್ ಆಫ್ H2O. ಆಮೇಲೆ H2O ಮಾಲಿಕ್ಯೂಲ್ಸ್ ಆರ್ ಡೈಪೋಲ್ ಬಿಟ್ವೀನ್ ಟೂ H2O, ದೇರ್ ಕಾಂಟ್ ಬಿ ಡೈಪೋಲ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಇಂಡ್ಯೂಸ್ ಪೋಲ್. ಮಯಾಂಕ್ ಫಾರ್ ದಿ ಎಕ್ಸಾಂಪಲ್ ಮ್ಯಾಮ್.
A mixture of methane and carbon monoxide.
That's all. Any mixture, for example, right? No? Carbon monoxide, okay, I'll take his example, and methane. Tell me, which is polar? I want somebody to answer now. Ruchit, Mr. Ruchit, can you tell me between carbon monoxide and methane, which can be taken as dipole? Ruchit Simha? Can you hear me, Ruchit?
Yes, sir.
Between carbon monoxide and methane, which is a dipole? Which can be considered as a dipole?
It is a carbon monoxide, sir.
Because it is?
Polar, sir.
Polar. Methane is?
Non-polar.
So therefore, it should be?
Induced pole, sir.
Exactly. Very good. Induced. So there you go. So some other example. Can I give an example of chlorine and oxygen mixture? Yep. Yes or no?
No.
No.
No, sir.
What kind of interaction could be there between chlorine and oxygen?
Non-polar, non-polar.
Meaning next category. I can't give this. Is that okay? So CO and methane can be dipole induced pole. Can I give an example of chlorine and HCl?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Which is a polar molecule?
HCl.
Which is non-polar?
H2. Chlorine.
Which will have induced pole?
Chlorine.
Chlorine.
Which will have permanent dipole?
HCl.
Okay, no problem. So this is about dipole induced pole interaction and dipole interaction or force. No problem. We'll take up the third reason for development of intermolecular forces. That is induced pole interactions. Forces or interaction in chemistry. Now, the terminology and polarity, we have already connected. Whenever I say dipole, it speaks about polarity. Whenever we say induced pole, it speaks about non-polar molecule. Correct, no? Now, this interaction is termed as induced pole interaction. This induced pole interaction can happen between two polar molecule or polar and non-polar molecule.
Two non-polar
molecules, correct? So this induced pole, polarity is being induced. So whereas in the previous case, it was happening between polar and a non-polar, here between two polar molecules, whereas here this interaction happens between two non-polar molecules. Interaction arises between to non-polar molecules. Between two non-polar molecules. When I say two non-polar molecules, they doesn't have dipole. I'll just continue this sentence. Which doesn't possess so permanent dipoles. Which doesn't possess permanent dipoles. Okay, so we can represent like this. When I say a non-polar molecule, it will have uniform distribution of charge around the nucleus. Okay, symmetrical distribution of negative. This is how symbolically we can represent a non-polar molecule. This is one non-polar molecule coming closer to another non-polar molecule. Like this. So both are non-polar. When they interact, come closer. Okay. So what would happen? When they come closer, natural thing that we can expect is negative-negative repulsion happens. Electron cloud get distorted in both the case. When they come closer, outside of both the molecules, what they interact is electron density, right? What it interacts is electron density. Electron density get distorted in such a way that the positive end of one, after distortion, electron-electron distort adre, positive ella one kade barute, positive kade negative zero, right? So distortion of electron cloud takes place in such a way that the positive end of one gets oriented towards the negative end. Okay, so let me write like this. Negative end alla innond kade push agide hage I am very poor in destroying. Okay, one second, it doesn't look nice. Okay, distort agide idu negative end akade hogirutte hagine. ಈ ಕಡೆಗೆ ನೆಗೆಟಿವ್ ಎಂಡ್ ಬಂದಿರುತ್ತೆ, ಸ್ವಲ್ಪ ಡಿಸ್ಟಾರ್ಟ್ ಆಗಿರೋ ತರ ತೋರಿಸೋದು ಅಷ್ಟೇ. ಓಕೆ, ಸೊ ದಿ ಪೊಲಾರಿಟಿ ಈಸ್ ಇಂಡ್ಯೂಸ್ಡ್ ಹಿಯರ್, ಮೀನ್ಸ್ ಡೈಪೋಲ್ಸ್ ಆರ್ ಇಂಡ್ಯೂಸ್ಡ್. ಸೊ ಬೋತ್ ಆರ್ ನೌ ಇಂಡ್ಯೂಸ್ಡ್ ಡೈಪೋಲ್ಸ್. ಬೋತ್ ಆರ್ ಇಂಡ್ಯೂಸ್ಡ್ ಡೈಪೋಲ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಪ್ಲಸ್ ಎಂಡ್ ವಿಲ್ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ವೀಕ್ ಎಲೆಕ್ಟ್ರೋಸ್ಟಾಟಿಕ್ ಫೋರ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ಅಟ್ರಾಕ್ಷನ್ ಟುವರ್ಡ್ಸ್ ನೆಗೆಟಿವ್ ಎಂಡ್. ದಟ್ ಈಸ್ ದಿ ಇಂಡ್ಯೂಸ್ಡ್ ಪೋಲ್ ಇಂಡ್ಯೂಸ್ಡ್ ಪೋಲ್ ಫೋರ್ಸ್. ಇದು ದಿಸ್ ಪರ್ಟಿಕ್ಯುಲರ್ type is also called by some other names like London force antare. A scientist by name Fritz London annavunu first idana thorskodtane ee tara irutte between two non polar molecules anta adakke adana London force. It's also called, ayen sari idu London antidye antandre namalu ittukottaralla chintamani anta hesri ittukottane. So hage London force, Fritz London anta avunu. It's also called dispersive force. Or dispersion force antanu kare. London force or disperse agide. Dispersive force. Induced force. Okay. So this. Can you therefore give me some examples of this particular kind?
Sir.
Huh.
Methane plus chlorine.
Methane plus sir.
Chlorine.
No. Yeah. Alle male inde ange inde munde maadibitta. So methane plus chlorine. Methane is polar or non-polar?
Non-polar, sir.
Cl2?
Non-polar.
Okay. Nan agadre, I'll take HCl and SO2. Tagola?
No, sir.
Idena agutte? Yav category agutte idu?
ಸರ್ ಪೋಲಾರ್ ಪೋಲಾರ್ ಇಂಟ್ರಾಕ್ಷನ್ ಇದು
ಸೊ ಅಂದ್ರೆ ಡೈಪೋಲ್ ಡೈಪೋಲ್ ಇಂಟ್ರಾಕ್ಷನ್ ಇಂಟ್ರಾಕ್ಷನ್ ಅಂತ ಬಂದಾಗ ನೀವು ಡೈಪೋಲ್ ಡೈಪೋಲ್ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳಬೇಕು ಬಿಟ್ವೀನ್ ಟೂ ಪೋಲಾರ್ ಮಾಲಿಕ್ಯೂಲ್ಸ್ ಆಮೇಲೆ ಕೆನ್ ಐ ಸೇ ದಿಸ್ ಆರ್ಗಾನ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಹೀಲಿಯಂ
ಯೆಸ್ ಸರ್
ವೈ
ದೇರ್ ಬೋತ್ ನಾನ್ ಪೋಲಾರ್
But these atoms, Alba, they're monoatomic gases, right? They're not molecules. Can I give?
They're stable.
No, whether it is stable or not, that's not the thing here. Oh, as a molecule.
Slight amount irbeka, Alba.
Enappa?
Ido induced sulfadru induce agutha.
Andre exactly correct. Ado argon is an atom. Atom is neutral, Alba. Atom by itself can't have a dipole. Alva, monoatomic gases andre eno, they are non-polar. Atom is non-polar. Atom by itself is non-polar, right? So, when it interacts with another, obviously, then can be induced pole, induced pole. So, perfect example, actually. Argon and helium can be an example. Likewise, shall I take H2 and N2? Ammonia banbidutha? N2 and H2 mix maadadra, ammonia banbidutha?
ಬರಲ್ಲ
ಮಿಕ್ಸ್ ಮಾಡಿದ್ರೆ ಬರಲ್ಲ ಟೆಂಪರೇಚರು ಕ್ಯಾಟಲಿಸ್ಟ್ ಎಲ್ಲ ಯೂಸ್ ಮಾಡಿದ್ರೆ ಬರುತ್ತೆ ಓಕೆ ಹೈ ಟೆಂಪರೇಚರ್ ಬಟ್ ನಾರ್ಮಲ್ ಕಂಡೀಷನ್ ಅಲ್ಲಿ H2 and N2 ಕ್ಯಾನ್ ಇಟ್ ಬಿ ಅನ್ ಎಕ್ಸಾಂಪಲ್ ಆಫ್ ದಿಸ್ ಪರ್ಟಿಕ್ಯುಲರ್ ಕೈ
ಎಸ್ ಸರ್
ಇಂಡ್ಯೂಸ್ ಪೋಲ್ ಈಗ
ಲೈಕ್ ಇದು ಯಾವ್ದ್ರಲ್ಲಾದ್ರೂ ಒಂದೇ ಒಂದ್ ತಗೊಂಡ್ರು ಸಾಕಲ್ವಾ ಅದೇ ಒಂದೇ ಜಾಸ್ತಿ ಗ್ಯಾಸಸ್
ಅಂದ್ರೆ ಬರೀ ಹೈಡ್ರೋಜನ್ ತಗೊಂಡ್ರು ಬಿಟ್ವೀನ್ ಟೂ ಹೈಡ್ರೋಜನ್ ಮಾಲಿಕ್ಯೂಲ್ ದೇರ್ ಕ್ಯಾನ್ ಬಿ induced pole interaction anta thana heltirod nenu
yes sir
exactly it's possible between any two molecule adike it is quite universal van der waal forces annodu quite universal neevu yavade tagoli bari hydrogen tagoli bari n2 tagoli bari argon tagoli bari helium tagoli alli kuda force of attraction irutte andre ondu innondru madhye ondu kind of relation establish agutte bari humans madhye alla ಮಾಲಿಕ್ಯೂಲ್ಸ್ ಮಧ್ಯನೂ ಒಂದು ರಿಲೇಷನ್ ಎಸ್ಟಾಬ್ಲಿಷ್ ಆಗುತ್ತೆ ಯಾವುದೋ ಒಂಥರದ ರಿಲೇಷನ್ ಇರುತ್ತೆ ನಾವು ಅಷ್ಟೇ ನಾವು ವಿರ್ ಆಲ್ ರಿಲೇಟೆಡ್ ಇನ್ ಒನ್ ಓರ್ ದಿ ಅದರ್ ವೇ ಫಸ್ಟ್ ಆಫ್ ಆಲ್ ವಿ ಆರ್ ಹ್ಯೂಮನ್ ಅಂಡ್ ನೆಕ್ಸ್ಟ್ ಆಫ್ ಆಲ್ ವಿ ಆರ್ ಆಲ್ ಲಿವಿಂಗ್ ಆರ್ಗ್ಯಾನಿಸಮ್ಸ್ ಒಂದೋ ಅದರ್ ಒಂಥರದ ರಿಲೇಷನ್ ಇದ್ದೇ ಇದೆ ನಮ್ಮಲ್ಲಿ ಓಕೆ ದಟ್ಸ್ ಫೈನ್ ಅಂದರೆ ಲುಕ್ ಅಟ್ ದಿ ನೇಚರ್ ಒಂಥರದಲ್ಲಿ ಸಿಮೆಟ್ರಿ ಕಾಣುತ್ತೆ ನಮಗೆ ಯೂನಿವರ್ಸಲ್ಲಿ ನಾವು ಹ್ಯೂಮನ್ಸ್ ಇರ್ಬೋದು ಅದು ನಾನ್ ಲಿವಿಂಗ್ ಥಿಂಗ್ಸ್ ಇರ್ಬೋದು ಕೈಂಡ್ ಆಫ್ ಸಿಮೆಟ್ರಿ ಇಸ್ ಸೀನ್ ನಮ್ಮ ಮಧ್ಯೆ ಮತ್ತೆ ಪ್ರಾಣಿಗಳ ಮಧ್ಯೆ ಹಾಗೆ ನಾನ್ ಲಿವಿಂಗ್ ಥಿಂಗ್ಸ್ ಮಧ್ಯೆ ಕೈಂಡ್ ಆಫ್ ಸಿಮೆಟ್ರಿ ಇಸ್ ಆಲ್ವೇಸ್ ಸೀನ್ ಲೈಕ್ ವಿ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಡಿಸೈನ್ಡ್ ಇನ್ ಸಚ್ ಎ ವೇ ದಟ್ ವಿ ಆರ್ ಸಿಮೆಟ್ರಿಕಲ್ ಮಾಲಿಕ್ಯೂಲ್ಸ್ ಆರ್ ಸ್ಟೇಬಲ್ ವೆನ್ ದೇ ಆರ್ ಸಿಮೆಟ್ರಿಕಲ್ ದೇರ್ ಇಸ್ ಎ ಇಂಟ್ರಾಕ್ಷನ್ ಬಿಟ್ವೀನ್ ಮಾಲಿಕ್ಯೂಲ್ ವಿ ಟೂ ಆಲ್ಸೋ ಇಂಟ್ರಾಕ್ಟ್ ಓಕೆ ಎನರ್ಜಿ ಆಲ್ವೇಸ್ ಸ್ಟೆಬಿಲೈಸ್ ದಮ್ ವಿ ಟೂ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಎನರ್ಜಿ ಟು ಲಿವ್ ಕೈಂಡ್ ಆಫ್ ರಿಲೇಷನ್ಸ್ ಅದೇ ಫೈನ್ Fine. What we'll do is now, we have seen all different kinds. If you summarize this, one molecule, inon molecule, jothege bandre, one interaction develop agutte annadu moral of the story. Ad yavade molecule agirli. Polar and polar bandre, yes. Adu tumba obvious adu. Polar and non-polar bandre, polar molecule, it will induce polarity into non-polar molecule, then develops. If ನಾನ್ ಪೋಲಾರ್ ಅಂಡ್ ನಾನ್ ಪೋಲಾರ್ ಬಂದ್ರೆ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಕೂಡ ವ್ಯಾನ್ ಡರ್ ವಾಲ್ ಫೋರ್ಸಸ್ ಬರುತ್ತೆ ಅನ್ನೋದು ಸಮಥಿಂಗ್ ಡಿಫರೆಂಟ್ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಇಟ್ ಇಸ್ ಯುನಿಕ್ ಫಾರ್ ದ ರೀಸನ್ ದಟ್ ಇನ್ ಬೋತ್ ದಿ ಕೇಸ್ ಪೊಲಾರಿಟಿ ಇಸ್ ಇಂಡ್ಯೂಸ್ಡ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಡೈಪೋಲ್ಸ್ ಆರ್ ಮೊಮೆಂಟರಿ ಕ್ರಿಯೇಟೆಡ್ ಆಸ್ ಲಾಂಗ್ ಆಸ್ ದೇ ಆರ್ ಟುಗೆದರ್ ಇಲ್ಲಿ ನೀವು ಜನರಲ್ ಆಗಿ ಬೈ ಯೂಸಿಂಗ್ ಯುವರ್ ಕಾಮನ್ ಸೆನ್ಸ್ ಇಫ್ ಯು ಅಪ್ಲೈ ಅಂಡ್ ಟೆಲ್ ಮಿ ಬಿಟ್ವೀನ್ ಅಮಾಂಗ್ ದಿ ತ್ರೀ ಡಿಫರೆಂಟ್ ವ್ಯಾನ್ ಡರ್ ವಾಲ್ ಫೋರ್ಸಸ್ ಹಿಯರ್ ಡೈಪೋಲ್ 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 ಇಂಡ್ಯೂಸ್ ಪೋಲ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಇಂಡ್ಯೂಸ್ ಪೋಲ್ ಇಂಡ್ಯೂಸ್ ಪೋಲ್ ದಟ್ ಇಸ್ ಡಿಸ್ಪರ್ಸಿವ್ ಫೋರ್ಸ್ ಓಕೆ ವಿಚ್ ಈಸ್ ಸ್ಟ್ರಾಂಗೆಸ್ಟ್
dipole dipole
dipole dipole
alva so for the reason that magnitude of negative charge and positive charge will be more the magnitude of negative charge and positive charge only will decide the strength of the bond alva illi since it is being induced the magnitude of negative and positive charge would be less magnitude kammi adre electrostatic force of attraction kuda kammi agutte the bond becomes weak so hagadre the strength of the bonds order tagondre order of strength of the interactions order of strength of interactions So dipole. Dipole is stronger when compared to dipole induced pole. Is stronger than induced pole induced. So this is how. ಇದಾದ್ಮೇಲೆ ಇಲ್ಲಿ ಇವೆರಡೂ ಬೈ ಅಂಡ್ ಲಾರ್ಜ್ ದಿಸ್ ಫೋರ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ಅಟ್ರಾಕ್ಷನ್ ಸಿ ಎನಿ ಫೋರ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ಅಟ್ರಾಕ್ಷನ್ ಬಿಟ್ವೀನ್ ಎನಿ ಟೂ ಪಾರ್ಟಿಕಲ್ಸ್ ಡಿಕ್ರೀಸ್ ವಿತ್ ಡಿಸ್ಟೆನ್ಸ್ ಅದು ಇದೇ ಅಲ್ಲ ಈವನ್ ರೆಗ್ಯುಲರ್ ಬಾಂಡ್ಸ್ ತಗೊಂಡ್ರು ಕೂಡ ಆಸ್ ಆಟಮ್ಸ್ ಗೋ ಫಾರ್ದರ್ ದಿ ಬಾಂಡ್ ಸ್ಟ್ರೆಂತ್ ವಿಲ್ ಡಿಕ್ರೀಸ್ ಎ ಲಾಂಗರ್ ಬಾಂಡ್ ಇಸ್ ವೀಕರ್ ಬಾಂಡ್ ಎ ಶಾರ್ಟರ್ ಬಾಂಡ್ ಇಸ್ ಸ್ಟ್ರಾಂಗರ್ ಬಾಂಡ್ ಯು ವುಡ್ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಸೀನ್ ಇವನ್ ಇನ್ ದಿ ಯು ನೋ ಕೆಮಿಕಲ್ ಬಾಂಡಿಂಗ್ ಆಸ್ ಬಾಂಡ್ ಆರ್ಡರ್ ಇನ್ಕ್ರೀಸಸ್ ಸ್ಟೆಬಿಲಿಟಿ as bond order increases stability increases why as bond order increases number of bonds increase length decrease strength increases correct no so that's the thing so shorter the bond stronger is the bond longer is the bond weaker is the bond like that okay so the force of attraction is inversely proportional to distance always distance between the atoms or general agi particles and barbartina adenadu molecules athwa atoms illi particular case alli in case of dipole in case of dipole and dipole alli okay the van der Waals forces in this particular case van der Waals forces is inversely proportional to the distance is r anta tagondre r cube tara vary agutte okay between two particles if distance r increases van der Waals forces decrease as 1 by r cube tara vary agutte okay so whereas in case of dipole induced pole and induced pole only induced and induced pole okay in both the case the van der Waals forces this page has become non responsive the case bariya kaagta illa namage van der Waals forces I'll take the next page inversely proportional to r to the power 6 tara vary agutte okay andre solpa distance jaasti adre between particles van der Waals forces thumba drop agutte r to the power 6 illi solpa drop agutte and these van der Waals forces ella operate agudu in the range of around 100 to 500 nanometers range alli astu close agirbeku particles solpa dura hodre agle because they are already weak the van der Waals forces will drop is that okay iga what I'll do is I'll give some combinations a combinations alli yav force act agutte anta helbeku aita what is
dipole induced dipole
N2 is non-polar ಆಗಿದೆ ಫಸ್ಟ್ ಇಂಡ್ಯೂಸ್ಡ್ ಅಂತಾನೆ ಅದು ಕರೆಕ್ಟ್ ಆಗಿ ಬರ್ಕೋತೀನಿ ನಾನು ಇಂಡ್ಯೂಸ್ಡ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಡೈಪೋಲ್ ಓಕೆ ದೆನ್ ಕಮ್ಸ್ ವಾಟ್ ಕುಡ್ ಬಿ ದಿಸ್ No idea.
Induced pole.
Okay. Induced andre eradu kadege adu non polar adu. Hydrocarbons by and large are non polar. Okay. So induced pole interaction. okay na, then comes okay
induced
Can you
that's ionic bond
so it is not van der Waal at all it's ionic rather it's not an interaction we call it as bond itself how about cl minus methane similarly
induced
NO3 minus Ne neon you are telling or chlorine and methane
chlorine methane is induced
okay I and I sure ah?
yes sir
ile NO3 minus and neon
induced sir
wrong ಅಂತ ಹೇಳಾಗಿದೆ ಐ ಥಿಂಕ್ ಯು ಕ್ಯಾನ್ ಅದರ್ವೈಸ್ ಥಿಂಕ್ ನಾವ್ ವಾಟ್ ಕುಡ್ ಬಿ ದಿ ರೀಸನ್ ಅಂತ ಏನೋ ಹೇಳ್ತೀರಾ ಯಾಕೆ ರಾಂಗ್ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳಿದೀನಿ ನಾನು
It's Cl minus, so there will be a dipole.
Cl minus alli dipole by itself, no. Cl minus negative irodrinda, the uniform distribution. Bari, it's a mono atomic ion. Okay, so uni negative ion, right? Ya keredu rangam thirpai. Okay, hint is. Look at the nature of van der Waal force. Between what kind of species or molecules it arises. Based on that, you will become. Yeah,
it's because it's between an ion and a neutral molecule.
So what? So how does it become wrong? Ega van der Waal forces are weak forces that arise due to unit charges or less than unit charge.
Less than unit charge.
Less than unit.
Adhe point ashtane inenilla. Between an ion and a molecule barodu van der Waal force alla. Okay? It has one negative charge athwa illond negative charge ide. Hage neevu yavado ondu Mg2+ tagondo ಅದ್ರ ಜೊತೆಗೆ ಇನ್ಯಾವುದೋ ಒಂದು ಮಾಲಿಕ್ಯೂಲ್ ಮಿಕ್ಸ್ ಮಾಡಿದ್ರೆ ಲೈಕ್ ಮೀಥೇನ್ ಅಂತ ಅದು ಕೂಡ ಅಲ್ಲ ಅಂತ ಓಕೆ ಯಾಕೆ ಅಂದ್ರೆ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಲೆಸ್ ದಾನ್ ಯೂನಿಟ್ ಚಾರ್ಜ್ ಇದ್ರೆ ಮಾತ್ರನೇ ವೀಕ್ ವ್ಯಾನ್ ಡರ್ ವಾಲ್ ಫೋರ್ಸಸ್ ಅಂತ ಕನ್ಸಿಡರ್ ಮಾಡ್ಕೋತೀವಿ ಅಂತ ಓಕೆ ಸೊ ದಿಸ್ ಇಸ್ ಬಿಟ್ವೀನ್ ಎ ಪಾಸಿಟಿವ್ ಚಾರ್ಜ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಎ ನಾನ್ ಪೋಲಾರ್ ಬಾಂಡ್ okay so these cases okay in this particular these three cases they are not under van der Waals forces. Forces, because a unit charge is not involved in van der Waals forces. Van der Waals force, VW force, I write. Okay, so that's the reason. In a ionic bond, go to namge alli kuda hela. So that's fine. In on the bond there, adu will finish off hydrogen. ಈಗಾಗಲೇ ಹೈಡ್ರೋಜನ್ ಬಾಂಡ್ ಆಗಿದೆ ನಿಮಗೆ. ನಾನು ಸುಮ್ಮನೆ ಇಲ್ಲಿ ಒಂದು ಸ್ವಲ್ಪ ಎಕ್ಸಾಂಪಲ್ ಕೊಡ್ತೀನಿ. ಯು ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಟು ಟೆಲ್ ಮೀ ವೆದರ್ ಹೈಡ್ರೋಜನ್ ಬಾಂಡ್ ಎಕ್ಸಿಸ್ಟ್ ಇನ್ ದೋಸ್ ಮಾಲಿಕ್ಯೂಲ್ಸ್ ಆರ್ ನಾಟ್. ಆಯ್ತಾ? ಆಲ್ಕೋಹಾಲ್.
ಎಸ್ ಸರ್.
ಬಿಟ್ವೀನ್ ಎನಿ ಆಲ್ಕೋಹಾಲ್ ಹೈಡ್ರೋಜನ್ ಬಾಂಡ್ ಎಕ್ಸಿಸ್ಟ್ ಆರ್ ಓನ್ಲಿ ಫ್ಯೂ ಆಲ್ಕೋಹಾಲ್ಸ್?
ಎನಿ ಆಲ್ಕೋಹಾಲ್.
Water.
Yes.
Yes, sir.
Water is H2O. H2 is
no.
No. H2 is.
Sir, yes, it is a hydrogen bond.
No, sir.
H2S is not. Okay, HI.
No.
HF?
Yes.
Benzene?
No.
Glucose?
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. In solid state alla solution alla. Between molecules generally we expect the molecules to interact in the solution state, right? Solution or gaseous state. No problem. So benzene, glucose, I had given you this.
Yes. Yes.
Phenol. Yes. Okay. Those who are little amazed about why it is yes, why it is no, like that. First of all, we shall take the definition of hydrogen bond. Hydrogen bond is the electrostatic force of attraction that holds hydrogen atom of a molecule with electronegative atom of another or same molecule. Another or same molecule. This is the definition. So when I say electronegative here, most electronegative atoms only we have to be considered. Electronegative atoms, when I say, most importantly, they are fluorine, oxygen, nitrogen. These are three important. In some stray cases, like Cl and all, weakly are found to have some, but by and large, at our level, we just only sink down to these three examples. That means electrostatic force of attraction that holds hydrogen atom of a molecule with electronegative, most electronegative means either fluorine or oxygen or nitrogen only, electronegative atom of another molecule or same molecule. If the hydrogen bond is formed between different molecule, it is intermolecular hydrogen bond. If it is formed within the molecule, between the hydrogen and the electronegative atom, then it is intramolecular hydrogen bond. You would have studied all these things. So we'll just take the case here. Alcohol. Alcohols are those, for example, CH3OH, methyl alcohol. Correct? Now, hydrogen is attached to oxygen. First of all, hydrogen atom must be there attached to most electronegative atom. Most electronegative atoms, you have to remember, fluorine, oxygen, nitrogen. So hydrogen is attached to oxygen. First, hydrogen is there. Second point, hydrogen is attached to electronegative atom. Now, we'll take one more molecule of methyl alcohol. Now, when it comes like this, this hydrogen atom, this is delta minus, this is delta plus. So it can have interaction. This is electrostatic force of attraction that holds hydrogen atom of one molecule with electronegative atom of other molecule. That's the definition. Okay. Within the same molecule is which case? Can anybody give me within the molecule? Is there any example here? Or if it is not there, can you give an example where hydrogen bond is formed within the molecule? Meaning, give an example of intramolecular hydrogen bond.
Alcohol.
Alcohol. Between alcohol is inter. It is. I have just given no. Methyl alcohol is inter. Between water molecule, one water, another water, inter. Between H2S, there is no hydrogen bond only. There is no question. Between HF and HF, HF, another HF, inter it is. What is this? NO2, orthonitrophenol. There is intramolecular hydrogen. Correct, no? So, whereas paranitrophenol, hydrogen bond is over, no? In chemical bonding? Yes or no?
Yes, sir. He did it last class.
Then, come on, give me this answer. This orthonitrophenol is paranitrophenol. What kind of hydrogen bonding are expected in paranitrophenol?
Inter.
This is inter, exactly. Because the distance between OH group and NO2 group is long, so that this particular molecule will have interaction with another molecule of paranitrophenol. So it will have inter. This is intramolecular. So you also know that ortho and paranitrophenol, they differ by the boiling point, melting point, physical properties. These inter and intramolecular hydrogen bonding make physical properties also differ. So for example, orthonitrophenol will have low boiling point, whereas paranitrophenol will have higher boiling point due to intermolecular hydrogen bonding. Meaning, whenever intermolecular hydrogen bonds operate in any substance, boiling point, melting point increases. They increase, okay? Intra decreases. Between water molecules, one water, another water. Between two molecules is inter. Within the molecule is intra. So orthonitrophenol, salicylaldehyde, salicylic acid, they are all intramolecular. Okay, so this is it. So these hydrogen bonds will be formed. So two conditions. Which are the two conditions? First, hydrogen atom must be there. Second, must be attached to that hydrogen atom must be attached to most electronegative atoms. I'll write EN atoms, most electronegative atoms like fluorine, oxygen, nitrogen only. Only in these cases. Okay. For example, I'll take methyl chloride. Does it possess hydrogen bond? Methyl chloride?
No, sir.
No, because there is no electronegative atoms, most electronegative atom in one of this fluorine, oxygen, nitrogen. So it cannot. Ammonia, does it have hydrogen bond, first of all?
Yes, sir.
No.
Ammonia,
yes.
Because hydrogen is attached to nitrogen. NO2 has hydrogen bond. Nitrogen is there.
No.
Hydrogen itself is not there, right? There is no hydrogen only. There is no question. HBr, hydrogen is there?
No.
But no, sir. Any one of these three is not there. Like. Correct, no? Similarly, methylamine.
Yes.
Hydrogen is attached to nitrogen. Correct, no? So these kind of things. Fine. These are all weak forces which operate between any two molecules, van der Waals forces and hydrogen bond. So van der Waals forces are the weak forces which operate between any two molecules or atoms. They arise due to interaction between a negative charge which is less than a unit negative charge and a positive charge which is less than a unit positive charge. So that means they always operate between negative and positive charges which are fractional. Okay, so they are universal again, meaning they can operate between any two molecules. That is one another nature. Okay, and in bulk they always make a difference, and with respect to one single molecule the forces may not be that difference. Okay, that they may not make that much difference. In bulk they always operate and bring in a huge difference in physical properties and chemical properties. So when solid becomes liquid, becomes gas, the intermolecular forces decrease, whereas thermal energy increases. So thermal energy and intermolecular forces put together, a physical state of matter is obtained always. Is that okay? So with this, we shall conclude for today's class. So this is about different interactive forces. Next class onwards, we are going to take in this chapter the states of matter. We don't study all the three states. We importantly study the gaseous state. 80% of the syllabus is about gaseous state and the liquid state. Okay, and solid state of matter will be studied in the second year portions actually, which is a complete chapter itself, but wonderful chapter. Okay, so here we majorly focus on solid and liquid and gaseous state. So that we'll take up in the next class. So if you have any doubts or queries, you can always ask me. Otherwise, I'll end up for today.
No doubt, sir.
That's fine. So we shall stop at this stage. Next, we'll meet for the next class. Happy festival Navratri.
Same to you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Bye, sir.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.